for the nice for the invitation, first of all, for the nice introduction. Thank you all for holding out. I will try to be brief. As a university professor, I know that lectures are not very effective ways of making points, getting points across. Lectures at 5:30 or 6 p.m. after a day of lots of interesting other talks should be considered cruel and unusual punishment, I guess. But here we are. I have the task to do it. So I can make a short lecture. I can try to make it. It's difficult for academics. I have to switch, and then we are ready to go. The switch moved. Here we are.
Yeah,
perfect.
Okay.
So, the topic of the talk is actually assigned by Arnu. We talked a little bit about what I could talk about, and he said, why not information in space and time? And as Arnu mentioned, my specialty is space to some extent. The only thing I really know, if I ever knew, was how to produce spatial information. I can't say I know anymore. I can't use these devices anymore. But I'm certainly not an expert in the publishing business. I'm just a simple researcher today publishing. And the first things I wanted to do tonight is just to state very briefly some of the possibly naive and idealistic, they have been called, assumptions that I'm making about publishing. And if you disagree, you probably also disagree with some of the conclusions. So I say what truths we hold to be self-evident, citing a publication from 1776, I guess. These four things seem to be essential to me: that academic publishing should be open access by default. I'll get to this point at the end of the presentation today, what we mean by this. Academic publishing should deliver more than just papers. We have heard this all day long. The whole afternoon was devoted to also publishing data and other aspects, other supporting information. I think that a lot of the discussions that focus on cost and ownership in the stuff that we publish are often missing the point. Of course, cost is important, but it's a little bit of a red herring, and I can attest to that from my own experience with spatial information, with digital maps. Those mapping agencies who have focused on cost recovery are essentially gone today, if they haven't done something else, which is focusing on creating value. And there's a very prominent example, the UK Ordnance Survey, on the very difficult circumstances, special circumstances, has focused on cost recovery and was the only one that I know, at least, that has been successful in this, because they've also come along with a way of creating values. Others, like the mapping agency in the state where I'm teaching, Northern Westphalia, which has been considered one of the pioneers, actually, of moving the business of publishing spatial data into a new age, has gone under. It doesn't exist anymore. So the real issue, and of course that's nothing new, is how to create value. And I think the message I want to get across today, again, you, based on the previous assumptions, you can agree or disagree with this, is that there are substantial opportunities, obviously, to create value, and some of them are untapped, have not been exploited to the extent that I would like them to see exploited. And two examples of these less exploited, less talked about ways of creating value are creating vocabularies. Almost nobody has mentioned today that if you do linked data, then you have to enable this linking semantically. You have to make sure that people maybe not use the same vocabulary but can refer to some shared vocabularies. I think that's a role that the publishing business could, to some extent at least, engage in, and I haven't seen this happening yet. But that's really not my specialty. That's just something that comes with the day-to-day business of producing linked data and other information. And the second point I want to focus on, and that was the charge I got, exploiting location, exploiting space and time for access, filtering, reasoning, and I'll tell you a few ways that we can use space and time. Before I get to them, just briefly summarizing where I see opportunities to create value in a more general sense, apart from these two specifics I want to focus on. I think not so much anymore in creating access, in giving access, providing access to publications. I think this is almost bottoming out at this point because a lot of it is happening in a peer-to-peer fashion. Current challenge is that we hear other people talk about is providing access to data and to software and to models and to all the stuff that comes with the publications and the research. The downside to that is that a lot of that is happening peer-to-peer as well, but we have seen some very interesting, just now, some very interesting models to share the duties between the researchers and some organizations. And the second challenge, of course, access by itself is not enough, or it's too much. We want to filter. We want to have good means of finding in the big mess of things what we're really looking for, not just having access to it. So filtering is certainly a key challenge. There are some core roles in publishing that have been talked about today, such as archiving and quality control. And both of them seem to be vastly expanding in their importance today. The archiving, of course, not just of publications, but of the other things that are being published. Quality control in terms of, we've heard about peer reviewing today, about trust. Also in terms of simply creating tools. I keep being annoyed by how bad the tools are to run conferences or do peer reviewing in today's open source environment. Branding. Just a little story here. We had a conference created about 20 years ago, 18 years ago, fairly successful, which established its brand, of course, by being successful, was published in a well-known series of conference proceedings, and that same publisher accepted another conference last year under the same name in the same conference proceedings. This other conference didn't even, the name was actually not the point, but the acronym was the same, and their name didn't even spell the acronym, and then there were some other quality issues with the conference. I think that's an issue of how to deal with brands and some negligence in protecting brands that have been vested and invested in some areas. And finally, the innovations for creating value, linking link data, whether they're open or not, requires more than creating just a link on the web. It requires a persistent link, and it requires the vocabularies that I mentioned, and it requires some reasoning. Just connecting everything to everything else or something to something else is not good enough. Then you want to exploit that. You want to do reasoning of why this is connected and what this tells us about the contents. And finally, exploiting location and time, and that's what I'll talk about for the rest of the time. It's not just the realtors that say location, location, location. It is a mantra for them. It is a mantra increasingly for researchers in many fields. We have heard about biodiversity today, economics, a whole host of issues is being seen today. People have been talking about the spatial turn from a spatial perspective, increasingly from a spatial perspective, and also a temporal perspective. And clearly, publications, data, records, projects, publishers, authors, institutions that publish exist in space and time and act in space and time. And this spatial and temporal reference is something we are not really exploiting that much so far. This is just one way of illustrating that information about space and time is really about everything that we do, and of course we may be less interested in our private lives that happen here from going from the mall, from home where we stay at some point to the mall and then to the doctor's office, etc. But it's really true for just about anything that's happening in space or happening at all. And a famous story that we usually tell our students and everybody who needs to be convinced that spatial reasoning is useful is the story about Dr. Snow, who discovered apparently in the mid-19th century in London, based on spatial analysis, that cholera was linked to the drinking water that people were getting from some wells in Soho. The map here, it's not the original map, shows the black squares are wells, are water holes where people got their drinking water, and the red dots are incidents of cholera. And what he did is simply do a map where he showed, where he presented these two things at the same time and realized that obviously there in the center there is a higher incidence of cholera cases, and this probably has something to do with the drinking water well that is located right in the center. That's just one example of spatial analysis where something has been found in research. In this case, nobody knew about bacteria and how diseases are transferred at that time, but this has been discovered based on a spatial analysis. And generalizing this, is often done sort of tongue-in-cheek with so-called Tobler's first law, Waldo Tobler being an early pioneer of spatial information and mapping, still alive in California, Santa Barbara, who jokingly said at some point that everything is related to everything else, but near things are more related than distant things. And he's laughing today at how everybody makes this big deal about his Tobler's first law of geography, but something clicks here. And of course, you can express this a bit more scientifically, and you could say there is spatial dependence, there is spatial autocorrelation or correlation between things like drinking water and cholera incidences. But the point is that seems to be a phenomenon that is so pervasive that we better pay attention to where we can use that. And here's a case where we didn't pay attention, the financial crisis. This is a map of negative equity in some Los Angeles neighborhoods, around 2009 or late 2008, negative equity being the case that your house is worth less than what you owe your bank, and then you just close it and walk away and bring the key to the bank. And this is, of course, one effect that gravely aggravated the financial crisis, and it spread spatially, because if your neighbor does that, the likelihood that the value of your own house goes down is very high. Values of houses are strongly spatially correlated. So this is just one case where we might have seen some patterns before something worse happened by doing spatial analysis. What other cases could there be? What can we do? If space is so important, how can we actually use it if time is so important? Clearly, I said in the beginning, filtering is something we all wish would work better, and filtering by space and filtering by time, by temporal aspects, temporal metadata, spatial metadata is certainly something that is done increasingly, but could be done much, much more with very simple additional means, additional metadata, or not even metadata, but derived spatial and temporal attributes of some contents. If we do that, then we can connect to what's called spatial information infrastructures, which are standards primarily, established to help people share spatial information. There is the so-called OGC, the Open Geospatial Consortium, that has been active for 15 years or a bit more now. There is increasingly W3C with an interest in space. They're producing lightweight, the latter one, W3C, and a bit heavier standards, OGC, to create spatial information infrastructures, and in some cases they may be useful to share spatial data or spatial metadata. These two points are sort of motherhood and apple pie. That's obviously what you want to do, or at least the first one. The second one helps you when you talk about space and time and information in it. The third point is something that only dawned on me last year when we were starting a project that I will talk about. A key issue in dealing with all this data flood and deluge is identity reasoning. How can I find out whether two authors were the same, or even two publications are the same, or two institutions are the same? Our university, University of Münster, officially called Westfälische Wilhelms-Universität Münster, goes by 36 different names internationally. How do you deal with this if you have linked data? Somehow you have to do identity reasoning. Reasoning that two of these 36 instances of our university are the same is very easy if you have spatial, if you have coordinates in this case, or some other just toponyms or other spatial attributes. The same applies for a lot of activities in publishing. We are existing in space and time. We have some lifelines that exist in space and time, and our identity is very strongly determined by where we are and where we were at a certain point in time. Going to the contents, reasoning about process. Cholera, of course, was one such example. The financial crisis is one. Conflicts of interest. We've been looking at the use case for linked data in the publishing area. It would be nice if we had better tools to identify conflicts of interest. A lot of conflicts of interest happen by spatial collocation of people or of institutions or of projects. Spatial temporal collocation, of course. And these can easily be detected once you have the spatial and temporal metadata. I mentioned the lifelines. Some of this stuff might be useful for each one of us when we do life planning, when we try to find out what else we could do while we are at Berlin attending this conference. Whom could we meet? Whom could we talk to? Whom could we talk to next year when we are doing some planning for our other trips, etc.? So lifelines happen in space and time, as we've seen with the diagram, and they can be, and reasoning on them can be quite supportive and useful. And I've been talking all about geographic spaces so far, the physical space in which we live. A lot of spaces are increasingly considered interesting that are not physical, but that are abstract. And a lot of information science, of course, is looking at abstract attribute spaces, n-dimensional spaces, higher dimensional spaces. And once we have some good tools to do the reasoning in the geographic space, we can apply them for the higher dimensional, or not necessarily higher dimensional, abstract or metaphorical spaces. And this has been done for quite a while. The term for it is spatialization, and it has proven useful, essentially, to filter data. And the seventh point here, I could go on and on and on, but I try to keep it relatively brief. One of the big challenges at the moment, apparently, for the biggies in the information technology business, like Google and Facebook, is to bring together social networks with physical space. And one of them is pretty good at mapping and providing spatial metadata. The other one is pretty good at social networks. The one who, one of these two, or another one, who manages to bring the two together and to embed the social graph reliably, usefully into physical space will probably gain a lot. And this has been talked about for quite a while now. It's not making much progress at the moment. Each one of them is trying to do the other's expertise better than they're doing at the moment, but it hasn't really hit home. Just my personal list of why space and time could be useful. Here is a map to finish my story about space. Then I'll briefly talk about the project that we're doing in this area. A map of Europe, but it looks a bit funny, probably. But it also says why it looks funny. It's a map of river basins. The big purple flare there is, of course, the Danube. And you see the other rivers across Europe. This is what a lot of people are interested in these days as a bounding of zones of influence on our life, on ecology, on the future, on sustainability. These are the boundaries we are interested in. However, the real boundaries that we have to deal with are, of course, different and lead to silos, national silos, in which we hold data about rivers that are very difficult to break and to link and to combine so that we end up with this geography rather than with the national boundary geography. And that's just a spatial case of a much more general phenomenon that we have been hearing about in the morning. Our data are in silos. And these silos have geographic boundaries, they have temporal boundaries, they have especially disciplinary boundaries. But they also have format boundaries and institutional and legal and what have you boundaries. The main point is they are silos. And the other main point that was made in the morning is that the real issues today, the big challenges that we have to deal with, cut across these silos. The geographic silos, the institutional silos, the disciplinary silos. I don't think we've heard a lot today about linking data across disciplines. It has been said this is a disciplinary issue, but a lot of the problems today require transdisciplinary approaches which require breaking up these silos. So, finishing up, just a few more slides. LODO. The University of Münster has decided sometime during the last year to become, presumably the first at this point, linked open data university. and make their data holdings, research data holdings, by default open, at least, well, not only open, but also linked, as linked open data, and is currently building an infrastructure based on what they have already, which is CRIS, their research database, extending this, and this, the existing research database, consists essentially of data about the so-called 5Ps, people, publications, projects, patents, and prices at our university. All these Ps are registered centrally, and people are actually maintaining their own information. This database has just been put live over the past year and is now maintained and extended. And what we proposed is to add three more Ps. They seem to like Ps so much, so we sold three more of them, and said places, standing for space, for location, periods, standing for time, and properties, standing for anything semantic, should be added not only to the data, but to the reasoning mechanisms that come with these, with this database. What we primarily want to do, what the university primarily wants to do, is access to the research data, as we've been talking this afternoon. There's this wonderful German word, Forschungsprimärdaten, that's the basis, the rock bottom material that we want to have to, or want to be able to connect to from publications, but also from other Ps. And the way to do that, we felt, was to use semantic web technologies, linked open data technologies, and essentially triplify not everything, but a lot of things, because that gets us past a lot of the problems with the formats that we've been talking about this afternoon, by having a lightweight approach and doing RDF triples. Don't have time to go into more detail at the moment. Triplifying as a very simple data structure that is generic enough to expose some really useful information in the data holdings of researchers. But again, just producing the data wouldn't be enough. It really becomes interesting once you add the spatial reasoning, the temporal reasoning, and the semantic reasoning. And what you can do with this, I showed you on the previous list, some of the identity reasoning, some of the semantic reasoning that could be useful using these, the original 5Ps, but also the additional 3Ps. This all sounds very straightforward. It isn't, of course. And there's huge challenges, even technological challenges. The standards are not at the point where they're so easy to apply. The tools are not at the point where they're user-friendly. Not at all, by the way. I'm completely shocked how bad tools are to do simple triplifying or triple exposure. But this will improve by the use of them, of course. But the bigger challenges are, and some of them have been mentioned today, create the incentives that people do open up their contents. What does it buy them? Manage access rights. Open sounds nice, but not everything can be or should be open. And the policy at the university will probably be that by default it should be open. If it shall not be open, then you have to reason for that, but then you need protection and you need management of these rights. The third challenge, the lack of vocabularies. Once you want to do some interesting or some generally useful triplifying, you need some good vocabularies to do that, to express the relationships. Where do we get them from? Where do we take them from? Who curates them? Who makes sure they're really shared and not just a local hobby? The fourth challenge, I thought during the day, there is still a lot of assumptions in the air that science is just establishing facts, and then we start linking these facts, and then everything is happy and the world knowledge is out there. But science is not really about facts, or at least some people would say it isn't. Or facts in a different sense, factum, in the sense of made by some people. And a lot of the knowledge is the latest form of error, of course, and will be revised. And how do we deal with that? And how do we deal with the specific recognition that some of the things we are putting out there are assumptions, or claims, or constructions, or social constructions, etc. It's not as easy to just assume their facts and then link them to some other facts. And with this comes the whole issue of trust that has been mentioned today, and reputation. We're doing some work on trust and reputation modeling also from a spatial and temporal perspective, but a lot more needs to be done. There's very little useful work, at least that I know of so far, that can be applied to do automated or semi-automated trust and reputation computation. If we deal with space, we will deal maybe with coordinates, but that could be the exception. It probably is the exception. Most people think of coordinates, three-dimensional coordinates, when we talk about space. Most spatial information is in names, in toponyms, in names like Berlin or Münster, etc. And there is registers for these names called gazetteers, and they link these names to coordinates, but they need huge efforts to make them more usable, more broadly accepted, and link them to the reasoning that we plan to do in this loading project. So let me conclude. I started saying that there is probably more opportunities for creating value than we have recognized so far in the publishing area. That a lot of these opportunities, and even the classical opportunities, the classical value propositions like archiving and quality assurance, are growing, not shrinking. I think there's a lot of reason for optimism, and this is like a really fun place to be, which is built on optimism about the publishing business. Publishing data and software, archiving, and quality assurance I mentioned, provide persistent linking, provide persistent and shared and agreed on vocabularies that are simple enough so that they can be accepted. And then I tried to make an argument that location and time are key enablers for many of these opportunities, and maybe some of them we haven't even understood yet. And finally, the perspective on Lodom was just to wave the flag. We are doing something in this area as a university. This is not a research project at an institute level or so, although it's carried out at this level, of course. And it's only starting now. So you can look up lodom.de, but there's nothing there yet. We essentially start this year with putting the vision into practice, and we need all the help we can get from all of you and from many of our friends. So please help by asking questions. Thank you very much.
As I told you, he is a fast professor, and they are moving fast in this whole area of geographic information science, in which I take a personal interest as a publisher, because I think there is a lot to be done over there. And Professor Kuhn is also working for our small publishing company as an editor of a series. Are there questions? Yes, and you get a microphone. Just Fred Dilla, you made it, in spite of snowstorms in Delaware.
Despite snowstorms, yes. So I know you don't want to hear a publisher focus on cost, but Lodom sounds very interesting, but how are you putting the resources together? Has everyone in the university decided to donate resources to make this happen? Are there specific resources identified? Tell us about how you're doing it.
Well, I was hoping you would. Of course, that's always a break point. A lot of the things, again, I think are not primarily cost issues. It's a transformation of attitudes, of a recognition of opportunities that lure there. And some people, many people at the university, have independently of this plan, when they didn't even know about it, approached us because they knew we were in the semantic data area. Can you help us? We need to exchange classification schemes. We need to link to archive data through this and that. So the readiness is there. There is an issue, of course, of creating more of this, but that's the non-cost side. And then there is costs, very clearly. And there is ways, of course, to fund such things, and the university has put in some proposals at the national level in the so-called Excellence Initiative. We have no idea what the fate of these will be. We are putting together more proposals. We are looking at the European research project at the moment, and at the national one, or two national ones. We have to start small. This is an idea at this point, with a lot of support at the top level of the university, and with lots of good people working for it, and we'll see what we can put together.
Okay. More questions? Yes, over here.
Mark Harden, Publishing Technology. I wondered whether you could make a comment about the status of standards in location and time data, given that I can't persuade my American colleagues to write dates in the right format so they're intelligible to Europeans. Is there progress on standards, and could we just adopt some of those standards in our everyday work so that in the future those some capabilities could be exploited better?
Yes. Yes, I think the story, I'm personally a strong critic. I've been very much engaged in islamization activities in the mid-90s and have felt that they have gone a bit overboard, and as standardization often does, has become too complex. But when I tell this to people who are not in my field, they say, but we're looking at your field as a great example of pushing standards that help people share data. And I think it is. It is to a large extent. There is standards like the web mapping services, which allow you to share maps and some things around maps. There is the so-called web feature service from OGC, which allows you to share more interesting vector data, polygon data. And there's lots more of these. There is standards now for sensor data. There is standards for some other kinds of geographic data. And they're all neutral with respect to the vendor formats. And the vendors have bought into them. And each vendor today has to offer possibilities for the data that are potentially held. And in some cases, they are not even held anymore in the proprietary formats. They have to offer opening these up and servicing the data in these standards that OGC and to some extent now W3C has created. So I think the news is overall very good for the geospatial field, and I've heard from many places now that maybe the GI people, the geographic information people, are the ones who are really building an information infrastructure that is getting over the format barrier issue.
And it is everywhere. Parcel services know where the packages are. And truck drivers know, the bosses of truck drivers know where the trucks are. And when I use my telephone here in Germany, Google asked me, can we use your location? So we seem to be known everywhere in time and space. And that is also a potential danger, I think. Maybe you can elucidate on that.
And that's a big topic, of course.
Shortly.
Location is clearly affecting privacy tremendously. We all know that, and that's public knowledge now in the press. Our role, all of us, but specifically people in the geoinformatics business, is to see this as an opportunity, because we're doing technology for spatial information. We also can do technology to protect privacy based on spatial information or potentially endangered by spatial information. And there's a lot of simple measures that can be taken. Just one brief story about this. I heard a project was ruined in Germany because they wanted to track individual vehicles for some traffic modeling stuff and were not allowed to track the license plates. There's no reason you need to track or to recognize the numbers on the license plates. You just need a bit pattern, a graphic pattern of the license plate. And you can easily recognize vehicles by license plates, of course. They had to resolve this with a very strange other method of identifying colors on the roof and shapes, etc. So there is simple technological means to assist privacy-protecting measures rather than to complain about and say this is hopeless. Or so. But it's a big issue. It's the big one that faces us in the spatial field at the moment.
I wish my cat had an identifier because it ran away.
Kids do by now.
Yeah. Any more questions? Yes, one last one. Oh, that's very good, Marcus. Marcus Liebecki, because that will be also my closing remark.
Thank you. Marcus Liebecki, German Research Center for Artificial Intelligence. So actually I have maybe remarks and a few minor questions. Maybe they are more technically. But the first question is, in this LODOM project, do you request people to enter this data now in a semantic format, or do you have automatic tools somehow creating the automatic data? How do you create this data?
First of all, we haven't done it yet, right? We're just starting the project. The way we want to do it is to offer tools that are simple enough for those who want to do it. At this point, there is no obligation that you now have to go back through your data holdings of the past 20 years of your career and translate them somehow into a new format. So what should be there are simple tools that enable essentially push-button capacity to triplify if and when you want to open up some content. And the tools are there. You know, it's just an issue of, and you know that, to aggregate them in a form that is simple enough for the biology researcher and the historian to use it on a day-to-day basis.
So, but this would require some more manual effort, right? entering the data in that tool next to or besides all the other tools where the data is added. So maybe there are automatic services. And there is another problem. You said first in the talk, LOD was not addressed today. It was addressed yesterday by my colleague. And I really appreciate this project. It's a very nice thing. But what is with mistakes? So DBpedia, as you know, is a very big LOD service somehow. And there are many errors inside this data as well. So what happens if somehow accidentally maps now the University of Münster to some other university in America, and then there is a mistake, I don't know, and it's treated as the same entity? So there are these issues, and so the benefits you mentioned always have this minor issue that it might not be perfect.
Right? Absolutely. Perfection is not the goal. And I think it's a good thing that these errors are coming out. The errors are in the data usually. Of course, you can create errors by the linking, but a lot of the errors that are in the data come out by the linking across the different silos. And the more transparency we create, the more ease we give people to link to other data collections, the more these errors come into the open, which is a good thing. That's what science is about. But also the less likely they are to be aggravated or created in the first place.
Thank you.
Okay. Well, thank you, Werner.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you all.
This is, yeah.